and to believe as evolution as their God. How sad it is. Guide and lead us this morning as we study your word. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Okay. We do have copies of our latest newsletter in the back. If you don't have a copy, we still have to send out some. We sent them out earlier, but we didn't get them to all of our mailing list because my mother passed away and we had to go to Texas. But interestingly enough, we just sent them out before we left for Texas, and a number of people in Texas when we got there said they got it and they just loved the newsletter. So that was good to hear from them, and that people are enjoying the truth. Now, again, my mother passed away recently. She was 89 years old, the age of the Queen of England. And I don't want to get into it too much, but it was a very nice service. It was well attended. We appreciate that. I got to see a number of relatives that, well, I haven't seen personally in over 40 years. So it was good to meet with them. And we just had a great time in fellowship. And I know my mother would have been blessed by that. And that was part of her wishes as well. Interestingly enough, when we were, a lot of us went to eat after the funeral service, and I was meeting with my cousins, Linda and Diane, who lived there in San Antonio, and Linda was telling me all about the family, and a lot of it I knew, but some of it I didn't know. For instance, I didn't know, and she has proof of it, and she had apparently some notebook from, I'm going to say, her great-grandmother that was handed up through the family line on my father's side. And she said, did you know, for instance, that we had one of our relatives on the Mayflower? And I said, no, I didn't know that. I really didn't know that. He says, yeah, you know, she had the proof and everything. And I thought that was very flattering and very interesting to know. So, hey, you never know when you get together with your family, the things, interesting things you can find out. And it did make me a little sad that our family hasn't been communicating. Not because we're mad at one another. You just get lost in your own world and busy in your own things that you have to do. And made me sad that I hadn't kept in better communication with my family over the years. But it was a good family reunion. And, you know, my mother, just had, she had cancer. From what the doctor said, I'm going to guess a year and a half ago or so, cancer of the pancreas. They wanted to send her to Shreveport because she lived in Monroe. We moved her from San Antonio, my brother did, to Monroe, Louisiana, so because that's where he was working and living at the time, so he could keep an eye oversee my mother and how she was doing and all that. And my mother said, though, she did not want to go to Shreveport to get the chemotherapy and all and go through all the so-called modernistic preventions against cancer at that time that they were telling her about. She says, I just want to go home. And I don't even want to go to an old folks home. So she did not, she never went to an old folks home. And I was thinking, well, maybe she better go. Well, who am I to say? Because she lived pretty good up until the end. And, of course, in the end, she had to start getting morphine because the pain grew, but it wasn't, most of the time she was pain free. And we were wondering why mom lived as long as she did. Now, we believe that there were prayers and all that, but one other reason my wife and I were thinking about is because my mother did not get chemotherapy and the cut and burn process of the medication and pharmakia and what the doctors prescribe today. And so we believe that's one reason that she lived as long as she did and relatively pain-free. So we're very thankful for that. Okay. And thank you all, those of you who knew about it. I know a lot of you didn't know. There wasn't enough time to notify many people. But for those of you who did know and prayed and lifted us up in your prayers, we appreciate it. And, well, as I said to a number of people at the gathering in San Antonio, because that's where my father was buried, and my mother wanted to be buried next to my father, and that's where the funeral service happened in San Antonio. We all got to go, and we're in the Lord's hands, are we not? And I think my mother is in a better place. And her problems, her sufferings, and things that she was experiencing there are all over. And to that end, you know, I'm very thankful. And she lived a good life. She was a Christian, lived a Christian life up until the end. And although my mother and I argued over things from time to time, you know, I loved her, and I'm going to miss her. And again, I appreciate all your prayers out there. Okay, we're going to begin our service. And I want to speak to you out of the book of Lamentations. Lamentations chapter 1. I don't know what it is all going to mean to you in going through this particular chapter, and I'm not sure how far we're going to get. Again, we are going to begin in the book of Lamentations because I think in many, many ways this speaks to what is happening to our once great nation, the United States of America. It is so sad to me every time I think about it, just about, that we were truly founded as a Christian nation. We were founded as a Christian republic. And the Antichrist, and again, I've gone over it with you before, there are many Antichrists today that exist of various forms, types, philosophies, religions, etc. Jesus said, and I believe it, you are either for me or you are against me. And I believe it is that clear, it is that plain, and that simple from what the Lord Jesus Christ told us. There is no other means by which man can be saved except through the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not Jesus plus Muhammad. It's not Jesus plus Buddhism. Not Jesus plus Hinduism, not Jesus plus Judaism. It's Jesus only. Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, who came to redeem his Israel people, his covenant people. And that entails quite a bit of studying. I don't know why so many Christian people are ignorant of this biblical fact. Why? Well, One of the main reasons is because they're not really reading God's word to absorb what the word says. They're listening too much to these modern day denominationalism, dispensationalized preaching that you're going to hear from Hagee and those types. Are they preaching who the true covenant people are? No, they're preaching who that the Jews are God's covenant people. I found it, we had a little bit interesting discussion as we drove by 1604, which we had to do a couple of times. And right there in San Antonio off of 1604 is John Hagee's church in big letters, John Hagee's. Yeah, it's a worship of John Hagee. And what a castle his church is, let me tell you. And if you went by the riches of his church and the size of his church and the number of attendees, I mean, they had, I believe as we were driving by, they had policemen there on the highway directing people in to the church. There were that many people attending the church where John Hagee's church. Anyway, I don't want to get into him. I want to move ahead here with the Book of Lamentations. Oh, good. We have the clock going in the background. Thank you. Because it wasn't on last time. Lamentations. It deals with the lamenting of the destruction of Jerusalem at the time of or during the Babylonian captivity. Babylonian captivity. Are we in a Babylonian captivity today? Yes. And the Bible refers to it as Mystery Babylon. And it is much the same as Babylon of old. And yes, y'all are hearing the woodpecker out there. What we had to prevent them got knocked down. Hopefully that'll... What's that?
In the windstorm.
Yeah, in the windstorm it got knocked down. We'll hopefully get that back up. But it's... Also, it's talking about, again, Jerusalem. Well, let's do a little comparison. Comparing the old Jerusalem with what we would call today as the new Jerusalem. And what might we refer to our blessed nation as? The new Jerusalem, I believe. Just as we would refer to Babylon as Mystery Babylon. Why might we call or refer to the United States of America as the New Jerusalem? Well, because interestingly enough, a number of our Puritan Pilgrim forefathers referred to this as the New Jerusalem. And when you compare what took place, for instance, in Lamentations, that time period, to what was taking place in the old Jerusalem, we see many correlations and many similarities, sadly, to what is happening to our beloved nation as well. And we can do this comparison because there are very few nations that you can look at and refer to them or as having a Christian beginning. Europe, we can still see and understand their Christian heritage. Despite what difficulties we had and warrings and fightings we had with our motherland, many of us, England. They were a Christian nation and a Christian people. And they have a great history of promoting the Christian faith. They did their best to spread it wherever they expanded their empire, India, Africa, and other places like that. But we're finding out that Christianity does not last long or does not mean a true Christian biblical spirit when the white man is gone. You can say what you want to about that, but there is something, as I have taught over the years, very biblical, and it concerns our heritage biblically, that we, the Anglo-Saxon, Scandinavian, Germanic, and Kindred people, are the true Israelites. And therefore, wherever we go, we spread the biblical gospel. Whether people of other races understand that teaching and their place, that's a whole new, different discussion to get into. I'm just kind of pouring out my heart here, as you can see. And I want to be a little bit careful because I don't want to condemn all people, all races, and I'm not ever doing that, except for the obvious when they deny the Lord Jesus Christ. Certainly they're wrong. But I'm more concerned with are the true biblical Israelites loving the Lord Jesus Christ and His Word, and are they doing their best to uphold their true biblical heritage? I hope you can understand the importance of what I just said. Are we, the true Israelites, upholding our true biblical duties and responsibilities? Because if we're not doing it, it isn't going to get done. And it will not be long maintained by any other people if we are not doing it. And of course, there's a mad rush to bring in the aliens and our enemies who are gathered about us in a sense. And look at the modern day mode of transportation and all the modern day, you know, computers and ways of communicating. Our enemies are taking advantage of these technologies, and they're infiltrating our nation in lots of different ways that many of us do not quite understand yet. But we have a duty and responsibility to protect our biblical heritage. Again, if we don't do it, who's going to do it? And if you bring in multiculturalism, as is being done today, what's going to happen to our nation over time? Is it going to expand? Is it going to escalate? Is it going to have an effect upon our once Christian foundation in this nation? Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. I want to take a little time to read you something that is rather long, but it pertains to our president. And I hate referring to Obama as our president. Nonetheless, it's what it is. Yeah, corporate CEO. This is something that Mike Gallagher, a radio host and conservative political commentator, Well, again, is a talk show host, and the title of what he read to his audience is it's called Obama, It Was You. Again, the title of this is Obama, It Was You. So bear with me here. And this is going to be a little bit long, but it needs to be said. And by the way, I just have to explain, this does not mean that I am ignorant to Zionism and what the Jews have been doing, but I am also not ignorant of what the Muslims have been doing, what the Islamic religion is all about. But especially in particular to the President of the United States, I don't believe these facts can be ignored. And it's scary to me, but it's also clear to me that we're having judgment upon us today because we voted in. And it's part of the promises of God. Yes, that he would bring curses upon us if we would deny him, deny his promises, deny his laws. He would bring about these things upon us. It's really that simple. So this is part and parcel to the curses that would be brought upon us. I better get started on this. I want to say a few other things about it. But I totally agree with what I'm going to share with you. Mr. Obama, or President Obama, this is why you didn't go to France to show solidarity against the Muslim terrorists. It was you who spoke these words at an Islamic dinner, quote, I am one of you, end of quote. I am one of you. Can you imagine the President of the United States ever saying such a thing? Let me go on. It was you who on ABC News referred to, quote, my Muslim faith, end of quote. You could say, well, that was a slip of the tongue. No, I say he was stating the truth and was corrected by the commentator to make him look better. All right, next. It was you who gave $100 million in U.S. taxpayer funds to rebuild foreign mosques. It was you who wrote that in the event of a conflict, quote, I will stand with the Muslims, end of quote. It was you who assured the Egyptian foreign minister that, quote, I am a Muslim, end of quote. There's too many, you say, well, these are coincidences. No, there's too many coincidences here to ignore the reality that our president is a Muslim, dear friends. Let me go on. It was you who bowed in submission before the Saudi king. How many of you have seen that? I've seen that many a time. Sickening. It was you who sat for 20 years in a liberation theology church condemning Christianity and professing Marxism. Think about it. He went to a so-called Christian church. Would any of us that, again, condemn Christianity and they also professed Marxism? Media hardly gives them any trouble or criticism for this. In fact, you would get criticized if you pointed this out and criticized him way back when, and it's never talked about since. Why, if anybody went to a KK or even walked by it almost today, a KK rally, or got one of their books and said, I'd like to see what this is about, and the media found out about it, they'd never let it go, would they? But they gingerly handled the president in this whole situation, and just to call him a Muslim, just to call him a Marxist, is going lightly with him. He is a very, very dangerous man. And he is not doing this by himself. He is a change agent of disaster. And he was being carefully groomed to be president of the United States. He was carefully groomed to do what he's doing to bring about the destruction of Christianity in America. You stop and you think about all the progress, so-called progress he's made in that endeavor. It is shocking. All right, let me go on. It was you who exempted Muslims from penalties under Obamacare that the rest of us have to pay. It was you who purposefully omitted, quote, endowed by our Creator, end of quote, from your recitation of the Declaration of Independence. It was you who mocked the Bible and Jesus Christ's sermons on the Mount while repeatedly referring to the Holy Quran. It was you who traveled the Islamic world, denigrating the United States of America. It was you who instantly threw the support of your administration behind the building of the Ground Zero Victory Mosque, overlooking the hallowed crater of the World Trade Center. It was you who refused to attend the National Prayer Breakfast, but hastened to host an Islamic prayer breakfast at the White House. It was you who ordered Georgetown University and Notre Dame to shroud all vestiges of Jesus Christ before you would agree to go there to speak. But in contrast, you have never requested that the mosque you have visited adjust their decor. I can't even believe that I'm reading these things. It's just shocking, but so factually true. It was you who appointed anti-Christian fanatics to your czar corps. It was you who appointed rabid Islamists to Homeland Security. It was you who said to NASA, foremost mission was an outreach to Muslim communities. It was you who, as an Illinois senator, way back when, was the only individual who would speak in favor of infanticide. Yes. It was you who was the first president not to give a Christmas greeting from the White House and went so far as to hang photos of Chairman Mao Zedong on the White House tree. Now, I know there's Christmas things in there, but still, photos of Mao Zedong? My God, if that doesn't explain it all. It was you who curtailed the military tribunals of all Islamic terrorists. It was you who refused to condemn the Fort Hood killer. Yes, how many of you remember that? Refused to condemn the Fort Hood killer as an Islamic terrorist, when clearly he was. It was you who has refused to speak out concerning the horrific executions of women throughout the Muslim culture, but yet have submitted Arizona to the UN for investigation of hypothetical human rights abuses. It was you. Well, it goes on. It was you who, when queried in India, refused to acknowledge the true extent of the radical global jihadist and instead profusely praise Islam in a country that is 82% Hindu and the victim of numerous Islamic terrorist assaults. It was you who funneled $900 million in U.S. taxpayer dollars to Hamas. It was you, think about this, who ordered the USPS to honor the Muslim holiday with a new commemorative stamp. These aren't little things. These all add up, folks. It was you who directed our UK Assembly, United Kingdom Assembly, to conduct outreach to help empower the British Muslim community. It was you who embraced the fanatical Muslim Brotherhood in your quest to overthrow the Egyptian president, Hosni Mubarak. It was you who funded mandatory Arabic language and cultural studies in grammar schools across our country. It was you who followed the Muslim custom of not wearing any form of jewelry on Ramadan. It was you who departed for Hawaii over the Christmas season so as to avoid past criticisms for not participating in seasonal White House religious events. It was you who was uncharacteristically quick to join the chorus of Muslim Brotherhood to despot Egyptian Hosni Mubarak, formerly America's greatest, strongest ally in North America, but remain muted in your non-response to the Brotherhood-led slaughter of Egyptian Christians. And lastly, get this, and a number of you do know this, it was you who appointed your chief advisor, Valerie Jarrett, an Iranian who is a member of the Muslim Sisterhood, an offshoot of the Muslim Brotherhood. Unbelievable, folks, unbelievable. And she writes many of the speeches and a part of the, to a large part, the policies and decision-making that goes on in the White House. Now, I understand the Jews are there, too. Don't think that I don't understand this. But right now, I'm pointing out, you know, and that's all I want to read on that. That's enough. But I read recently from some minister that was making light of the Muslims and wanted us only to think of what the Zionists are doing and what the Jews and the Talmudists are doing. And I certainly understand that. Believe me, I do. But I also want people to understand these Muslims are not our friends. But Pastor, we went and invaded Iraq and we were there out of the wrong reasons. And we went to war with them out of the wrong reasons. Brother, believe me, I know that. I understand that. And I understand why they're fighting back. But I also understand the Muslims are not Christian. The Muslims are not our friends. The Muslims are not happy in living in harmony with Christianity. There are many problems that we have with the Islamist and with the Muslim faith. And I'm not going to say to you all of what the Muslims believe is bad, wicked, and terrible. There are some things that they believe that are biblical. I understand that. But there are a lot of things that they believe are very wrong and very dangerous. And I believe the Bible points at the end time the fact that this false prophet, Islam, Muhammad, is going to be a problem. And it's rearing its ugly head today. Yes, because the United States has sinned against God. We can look at all these excuses and reasons, but the fact is, we cannot just close our eyes to the Muslim problem. No more than we can or should close our eyes to the Talmudic problem in our nation. No more than we can close our eyes to multiculturalism. No more than we can close our eyes to the black communism, the black groups that are a part of the destruction of our nation as well. And there are many other groups that I can name as well. But I believe when we're going through the Book of Lamentations, we can see all these warnings, and yet why are we blind? And go back over 50 years, why over the last 50 years have we not been warned over and over and over again that these things will happen and come upon our nation if we continue to sin against Yahweh? Why were not we continually warned of this? And yet I know some people today, oh, well, we've heard that before. I want to hear messages of love. You want to hear messages of love? I want to hear messages of love, Yahweh, to love the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't you? Are we loving Him? It's more important, far more important, that we love His Word, love His covenants and promises, love and appreciate our true biblical heritage, and we teach the truth of God's Word to warn Israel. God Almighty told us, the Israel people, over and over in His Word, remember what I did to you, how I brought you up out of the land of Egypt and delivered you from the strong hand of the Egyptians, the Pharaohs. It isn't any different today in many ways. What took place way back then? They were in captivity. We are also in captivity today. Why were they in captivity in Egypt? Because of gradualism. Because they slowly but surely, you know, they got more prosperous and more prosperous. And their prosperity started under Joseph. Don't forget that. And God used an Israelite, Joseph, as one of the main rulers who helped bless Israel. Did that really help Israel? Well, yes, it helped Israel, but it also, in many ways, brought about curses upon them because for some reason, we have forgotten who we were. We have forgotten our heritage again. We have forgotten what God Almighty has required of us. We have forgotten what God Almighty said to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. All those many biblical admonitions in the book of Genesis. And then when we get to the book of Exodus, you see, Israel has always had the word passed on to them. Israel has had a very high culture. Some of you may not completely realize this, but we haven't been like the Indians. We haven't been without the written word. The Hebrew language is a very ancient language that has been given to us from Adam. And you go on down to Seth, and look at the many years that after Adam, that ancestry lived and passed on tremendous, important God knowledge to our people. And Moses. And Moses passed this on to his relations. Not all of them kept up that true biblical faith, obviously. But it was passed on to Abraham. Did God Almighty, it's a simple question, keep His word and pass on His word to true Adamic people who love Him and love His word? Now, that's a very important question. The answer is yes, He did. And I believe those who stay in the word and are faithful to Him will have even more powerful biblical revelations passed on to them. There are untold, vital, important biblical mysteries and understandings that will be brought to us and our understanding as we remain and stay faithful to Him. I don't care what others in our family history have done, what sins they have committed. We can, in a sense, right many of those wrongs by remaining in that right relationship with Jesus Christ. Do you understand what I'm telling you this morning? It is powerful biblical light and understanding. And many of you have experienced this, have you not? Now, when we're getting into Lamentations, and I know we haven't gotten into it yet, really, but it explains that Israel, or the southern kingdom of Judah, that was the nation at that time because the northern house had already gone into captivity. But they had many, quote, lovers, enemies of Israel that they had joined with and engaged in this adulterous situation with. Just like we have engaged in adulterous relationships with many of our enemies today. And many of our enemies, sadly, we think are somehow godly, like the Jews. Are the Jews blessing us today or cursing us? I'm always asking, I will continue to ask that. And that is a very vital and key question still. Are the Jews blessing us or cursing us? And I'll add, when you look at the destruction that has been done upon our nation, and you compare that with the Muslims, what they have done against us, there's no comparison. We are suffering far more from the effects of Talmudic Judaism than the sad effects of Muslim, and I'm not praising either one of them. But Lamentations will deal with the decline of the southern kingdom of Judah. Also, we can add to that what is happening to us today with the term, biblical term, captive Zion, or captive daughter of Zion. And it all deals with the pain that we are experiencing today and what they experienced back then under Babylon. And it is very important to our awakening. Very important to our awakening that we understand what is happening to us today under Babylon, under Mystery Babylon. It is very important and was very important that the people of Judah, the southern kingdom of Judah, understand what was happening to them under the captivity of Babylon. Is it talked about in our churches? Do Christian people really understand what is happening to them today under the captivity of Mystery Babylon? Also, I will add that we're all going to see the spiritual failings. The spiritual failings of Israel. They lead to the gross loss, and we're experiencing that today, of our spiritual liberties. Think about all the liberties that we're losing in our nation today. And a lot of these things are part of our conqueror's attempts to bring about the destruction of Christianity and the destruction of Israel, or the conquering of Israel, the white Anglo-Saxon people today. Let us move ahead real quickly to Lamentations 1, verse 1. Quote, "What doth the city," the old Jerusalem, "what doth the city set, how doth the city set solidary? That was full of people, how is she become a widow, she that was great among the nations, and princesses among the provinces, how has she become tributary?" You know, they're taxing the heck out of us today, aren't they? Are they not? They're extracting tremendous wealth from America. I love how Donald Trump talks about what the Mexicans are doing, and the Japanese and the Chinese, just to name a few. They're taking tremendous wealth out of our nation, he says. And you know what? He's telling the truth. They're not the only ones. Look at what our government is doing. And many, many sources today, look at how the wealth is being sucked right out of us today. It's all part of our captivity. Verse 2, "She wept sore in the night, and her tears are on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she hath none to comfort her." Chee, boo-hoo, her lovers, her enemies will not comfort her. Are the Chinese comforting us today? Is the Mexican government comforting us today? Go on and on with it. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her, with the southern kingdom of Judah. They are become her enemies. What have they become? Her enemies. Do we understand them today as our enemies? Do you, Israel, do you, America, understand who your true enemies are? Or do you just look to the media today to tell you who our true enemies are? Is the media telling you the truth? Well, obviously they're not. They're lying to us. And if you believe what the media says, and, well, you're just going to live in ignorance, and you're going to continue to live in ignorance. I'd rather believe what God's Word says. Amen? God Almighty has not, never will, lie to us. We need to stay in His Word. Verse 3, "Judah is gone into captivity because of affliction and because of great servitude. She dwelleth among the heathen. she findeth no rest. All her persecutors overtook her between the straits. Between the straits? Now, that word has to deal with distress or pain. How interesting that God uses foreigners, the heathen, to bring judgment upon his people, and they find no rest. Are you finding any rest today? Or are the American people finding rest today? As I said, I was in the store the other day, and I couldn't help but notice a number of young people I walked by and the sad look upon their face. Now, I know there's not a happiness on the folks of the old, on the older folks either, but there was a distinct lack of happiness upon their faces and their attitude. And I had to feel sorry for them, even though a number of them had guys had earrings in their ears, and that's not necessarily only because they're homosexuals, and girls had earrings in their noses, and weird makeup in many cases, and weird hair. They paint their hair just weird colors today. But my heart couldn't help but go out to them and feel sorry for them because of our spiritual condition in America. And in many cases, baby boomers, it's your fault. I know they're the millennials. I know that they are part of their own destruction, part of their own national demise. We are all, in a sense, we have our guilt in that. Why are they unhappy, though? I want to ask you, why are they unhappy? Well, we could look at the economy, certainly because of the economy. But really because, as I read to you earlier, Obama is an enemy president. And it's not all because of him, but because of the people behind the curtain that are conducting a lot of the affairs out of the White House today. There are many, many enemies today. The Bible says there are many antichrists. When are we going to understand that these people are, quote, antichrist? They do not love the Lord Jesus Christ. They do not love his word. Now, we may have our divisional problems and denominational problems, and we can get into that as another subject. But there are many of our people who love the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know because of their ignorance of God's word, they are also part of the problem. But I know that they would not be participating in a lot of the things that are coming forth from our government today. I'll give them some credit for that. I don't want to all cast aspersion upon Judeo-Christianity. But because of their biblical ignorance, as I said earlier, they're aiding and abetting their own destruction. They're aiding and abetting the Antichrist because they're so woefully ignorant of what God's Word is telling us. And again, we find no rest. None of us feel at rest or at peace, do we? We feel the pain. Yes, we feel the pain that Yahweh feels because of our deceit, because of our rebellion against God's laws. And who am I referring to? Israelites. I'm not referring to the other people. I'm referring to Israel. For we have sinned. We have been given God's law. We have been given the great covenants and promises, and we have denied our great biblical heritage. And that has to change. That message has to be taught. That biblical message has to be understood in a greater degree. And we have to do that. We have to continue to preach and promote God's word. I want to say this in closing. Ladies and gentlemen, I understand that what I have said, even to a light degree by a number of ignorant white people, will refer to what I have said as hate. And there are a lot of them that say, I want nothing to do with, quote, hate. Well, I don't want anything to do with the wrong type of biblical hate. But as that poem says, that great poem, there was a time when the Saxon began to hate. What do you think that great poet was talking about when he wrote that poem, when the Saxon begins to hate? It took many decades, perhaps centuries, before the white man began to hate. Why did the white man begin to hate? Are there things, again, that we are to hate? You know, we like to wallow in, oh, it's so cute, and oh, it's so loving to embrace paganism. These verses are going to get into the holy days. Let me just ask you, Israelites, do we embrace the holy days, tabernacles, Pentecost, all the holy days that brought joy to Israel at one time? No, we like to get together and celebrate pagan Christmas, pagan Halloween, pagan Easter, pagan this, pagan that, anything that the world celebrates. Many families tell me, well, we love to get together because it brings joy to our heart to have the Christmas tree and all this other Santa Claus red stuff go along with it. You see, it's okay because, oh, there's the Santa Claus thing there, but we bring Jesus Christ and the birth of Jesus into the situation. You don't give gifts to Jesus. You give gifts to your children and put smiles on their face and bring them under this pagan Christmas tree to celebrate the so-called joys of Christmas. Are we celebrating true Christianity? Is God Almighty aware of this? Is it part of our paganization that's taken place in America? Now, I know a number of you celebrate Christmas. Again, I understand a number of you, you've had to marry into that, to that. And for many of you men, your wives would pull your ear off and make life miserable for you if you didn't do it, so it's easier to give, and I understand that. But that doesn't make it right. Some of you men and women need to stand up for what God's Word says. I think it's past time that we quit placating it and pussyfooting around about this and acting like it's okay. Pastor Barley, that's a strange way to end your message. Folks, keep going the way you're going. If that's what you want to do is wallow in paganism, even to a little bit, and say, well, this Judeo-Christianity isn't going to hurt any. Just a little dab of poison won't hurt us. That's, the enemy is way smarter than you are, folks, if that's your thinking. They know that taking a lie and mixing it in with the truth is all they need to do to get started with the destruction and the plot against Christianity. I will close there for now. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we love you. We love your word. May we continue to be faithful to your word, your truth, your understanding. May we put you, our high King, Jesus Christ. Keep referring to you as our King. We need your throneship power and kingdom authority to come forth. We pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, this earth, as it is in heaven. Jesus, we love you. And we pray again, thy kingdom come. Amen and amen. That you are a covenant-keeping God. Amen and amen. All right, we need to get moving here. First of all, I went and looked on my computer this morning, and we got several people writing on the newsletter. Here's one from Texas. Got your current newsletter. I love your newsletter. These are very informative. It goes on from there. People are responding to the truth, and we're putting some pretty deep things, some pretty serious things in there, but people are waking up. They're taking notice more and more of what's going on. Here's something somebody sent me, and I knew it already, but it's very interesting. The Vatican, how many of you heard this? The Vatican says Jews don't need Christ to be saved. I think that's kind of humorous. It's kind of humorous. And, of course, if you want the proof on that, just look it up. There's a Jewish website on the more and more what the Vatican says and what the Vatican's doing. The Vatican coming over here and spending time with the president is not a good blessing thing. I say that because I recently went over some friend's house, and, you know, they're aware of a lot of truth out there, but they're into kind of what you were saying, George, on the Planet X, but they're pushing this lady who's pushing Planet X, and she's Catholic, and she's from Alaska, and she was saying to her readers, she has a big website, that the Pope coming over here was actually a blessing and good for us, and he has a good agenda, and what he's saying is really going to bless America, and they were getting into this and pushing that agenda. Because they believe the Planet X thing, they jump to automatically forgetting everything they know about the Catholic Church, their history, what they've been responsible for, the corruption in it. all of a sudden, oh, this lady says the Vatican's good. Folks, stay in the Bible. Believe the Bible. We weren't founded on Catholicism. If you want to get into South America and you want to get into Mexico, there was much more of a heavy influence of the Catholic Church there. And they laid their seeds there, and look what's happened. But we're mainly a Protestant nation, founded by Puritans and Pilgrims who weren't perfect in their theology, and they didn't have all understanding, but they had a deep-rooted foundation in Jesus Christ and the Christian faith, and bringing us out of the bondage of the Catholic Church and the Inquisition and all that was entailed in Catholicism. And what they did, if you follow the Puritans and the Pilgrims, they actually established a lot of the universities, the old universities like Yale, etc. And they were founded by Christians and upon Christian principles. Now, those universities, as I've told you before, are not Christian today, obviously. But because Christians have gotten away from their covenant responsibilities, the promises of God, the biblical foundation for which this nation was founded, the Christian principles, our Christian heritage. And if you get into that Christian heritage, it goes deep. The enemies of Christ, the enemies of the Bible, hate the Word of God. And they want to do everything they can to silence that Word and corrupt that Word, to silence that Word. So, this gets into partially what we're into today in our study in Lamentations. And I want to continue with our study there. This will be part 3. And we're into chapter 1 in the book of Lamentations, the downfall of Jerusalem. And you can't help but read about the downfall of Jerusalem and the Judah kingdom and not realize it's a tragedy. You cannot help but correlate what happened to them with what is happening to us today in the United States of America. This was founded as a Christian nation. It is no longer, obviously, a Christian nation. We're far afield from applying and following the Bible and biblical principles in our nation. We're following liberalism, progressivism. We're doing everything we can. Or the enemies of Christ have done everything that they can because they have the money, they have the power. They've always had the money. And one thing that our enemies do understand is that money talks. We're under the golden rule. He who controls the gold rules, right? And we're under that rule today because it appeals to the flesh, even the flesh of Christians. Dare you say, Pastor? Absolutely. We are Christians are not immune from the lust of money, the lust of promises from the government, even. Are they? You look at the Democratic Party. Why, to hear some people talk about it, you think only the black people vote Democratic. No, there's a heck of a lot of white people who have government jobs, government security, supposedly. State, county, federal government, they have these government jobs and these government benefits. And they love to hold on to those benefits, do they not? And you may say, well, benefits are not bad. Benefits are good. Yes, they can be good if understood properly, used properly, and we had the proper understanding about the role of government. And I'm not just picking on government. I mean, we can get into all kinds of areas economically that we are in bondage over. It's not just one place we can point our finger at. God Almighty says He'll bring curses upon us in lots of different areas. And for us to look at one area was very naive, for one thing. He's affecting us all. Even if we're Bible-believing, church-going Christians, we're affected by what is happening to our nation today, and even Canada, Europe, all the end-time nations of what I have told you, and you know, the end-time nations of regathered Israel. So bear that in mind as we're going through this lesson. And we're going to talk, obviously, because in Lamentations, in this section, is talking heavily about our enemy. And we've gone into that. We're going to continue to go into that to a certain degree this morning with you. And we have lots of enemies in lots of different areas. And we ourselves, Israel, as you know, people that are on DVD and CD following us here, we are our own worst enemy in many, many ways, are we not? So we're not going to come out of the problem that we're in today until we repent. Oh boy, we're going to repent. We're going to do 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by name will pray and repent and seek my face, then I'll hear from heaven, I'll heal their land, etc. In repentance, you have to understand what biblically God Almighty is talking about. It means we turn from our wicked ways. We start obeying His commandments. Oh, you believe that we're just through obeying the commandments, we're going to get saved and we're going to deliver ourselves? Well, it's a good start for one thing, but that's not what I'm saying. We are saved only through the Lord Jesus Christ. But in following and serving and believing in and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ, that's following His commandments. Jesus Christ did not come to do away with the law, as I've told you before. You know it in His Word. He said in Matthew 5, if you do away with the law, you're going to be least in the kingdom. The only laws that were done away with are the blood-keeping laws and rituals done by the priests. Some of those laws were done away with. We're not saved by going out and killing the fatted calf and doing all that old ritual order. We're saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is very, very evident. But in that, we do not disregard His laws. You're not free to rape, you're not free to murder, you're not free to bear false witness, etc., etc., are you? And you would think that, again, in listening to some of this grace-only teaching by a lot of the churches out there. Oh, we're under grace. We're not under the law. Oh, really? Are you free to do whatever you want? Just wet your finger and stick it up in the air and see which direction the winds of politics or whatever religion out there is blowing today? God has his laws. They're not grievous. Man's laws are grievous. Just like I've told y'all before, pick up your IRS manual. There's more laws, regulations, and bureaucracy in that than is ever in all the laws. What was that, 600 something laws of God? There's more regulation, heartache, and burdens in the IRS manual alone. The EPA, get into all the regulations about the EPA, regulating businesses, regulating our freedoms, regulating our liberties that have put us in bondage under the government, local government, state government, federal government, doesn't matter. We're in bondage. Businesses are struggling to keep up with all the regulations. I mean, you take simple things, what you would think would simple, like, oh, gee, when you retire, you come under this new retirement regulations and Medicare and all that other stuff. You'd think that would be simple to understand, but even those are not simple to understand. Who do they apply to? If you're a Mexican, you would come across the border, and you can go to any Mexican organization that is funded by the federal government, and they'll tell you all your benefits. And you'll find out real quick, oh, gee, I can go to school free, I can get this free, I can get that free, I can do this and I can do that. All a taxpayer expense. Isn't America wonderful? No. Do they love us more because they get all these benefits? No. We'll talk a little bit about that this morning. But listen, because I've talked about all kinds of enemies, and we better be aware, not just looking in one direction or at one particular enemy. But we must understand this about our enemy. They're not here to bless us. Donald Trump has been talking about that. I'm not pushing Donald Trump for president. But a lot of others are talking more and more about this, that we better really open our eyes and our mind to whom the real enemy is. And I'm not saying the Muslims are the real enemy. Yeah, I am. I am saying that. But they're only part of who the real enemy is. If you don't understand the Jews and what the Talmud is and what the Jews really teach and believe, which is not Christian at all. The Jews are doing more in reality. People don't like to hear this. Oh, no, the Jews are God's chosen people. Don't you dare say anything against the Jews. Really? The Jews can blaspheme God Almighty, say all kinds of things against him and his word and their Talmud. It's just not the Old Testament, by the way. And they get all kinds of, they get up to $17 billion in benefits if you understood what they really get. Like I've told y'all before, if they're really God's chosen people, they ought to be blessing us. They're not blessing us, they're cursing us. All our economic systems, especially the Federal Reserve, are controlled by them, either directly or indirectly. All the heads of the Federal Reserve, I've told people this, and well, I don't care. They're God's chosen people. All the heads of the Federal Reserve are Jews. This Janet, what's her name? Yellen is Jewish. Yeah, Bernanke was Jewish. Burns was Jewish. Going on back, all of them were Jewish. Oh, that's just coincidence that they're all the heads of the... Really? Are you that naive? He who controls the gold, Mayor Rothschild said, I care not if we control the gold, the issue of credit in a nation, etc. I care not who makes its laws, because they'll control all the policy. Though if they control the issuance of credit in a nation, they don't care. They control it all. Yeah, Trump has been saying that too, to a certain degree. And good for him for waking this nation up to certain things. Our enemies in reality, because that's who and what an enemy is, they're not here to bless us, they're here to curse us. And we better quit treating them gingerly. We better say, no, we just need to get to invite them in, get to understand them more. Really? Get to understand the enemy until they what? Until they're entrenched in our nation? Until they start running for president, even? I know people don't want to hear this out of me, but I don't care if they like to hear it or not. I'm going to tell them the truth. Obama's an enemy. If you don't know that, you're a fool. You're aiding and abetting the destruction of your nation if you don't understand who Obama is. That's simple. That's just basic 101. Know who your enemy is. And in 7 years, if it's taken you over 7 years to figure that out, if it took you over a half a year after he was elected to figure that out, something's wrong with you. I knew it before he's even elected, obviously. Most of you knew it long before he was ever elected. Yeah, same with Bush too, I agree. Bush made it possible. Trump said that. Bush made it possible for Obama. He was right. Bush should have never got us involved in this Middle East war. You know, I'm not going to get into it because it would take too long. I guarantee you, the Middle East war has only benefited the Jews. They don't want this strong Arab thing. They want to bring their problem into the world in part. There's much, much more to it than that. And that's what's happened. They brought the Arab problem, Muslim problem, into the world. How do you like the Muslim problem, America? How do you like it, Germany? Because they're getting much, much, much more of that problem than we are. Is it blessing your nation? And then Merkel's on Time Magazine, Person of the Year. Oh, how wonderful. She's the cursing of Germany. And the people hate it. But you know what? God Almighty, just like in America, God Almighty's rubbing their nose in it. He's not through teaching them a lesson at all in this. But our enemy is here to curse us, and they're here to corrupt us. Can I get an amen? I like that one. They're here to attack. And listen to me, I'm telling you the truth, whether if you like hearing it or not, folks, they're here to attack our heritage and our culture. They don't like your heritage. They don't like your culture, especially if you're white. And especially if you're Christian. Our enemies do not love us, they do not respect us, therefore they do not honor us. And I'm not talking about all the races either. that who are not of our kindred, by the way. Let me add that so you will understand what I'm talking about. But there is a race problem, Whitey, and you better understand it. Oh, no, we're all the same. No, we're not. No, we're not. As I've told you, how can you watch Baltimore and Ferguson and what's going on in Chicago ad nauseum, all the other places out there, and think that we're the same? Again, first of all, we're not of the same skin color. Oh, but underneath, Pastor, we're all the same. Are you really? Are you really? Who's told you that lie? I'm not the same. Maybe you are, but I'm not the same. I think differently. I have different values than they do. Yeah, but if you come from where they came, you'd have different values too. You don't get it. And you know why I'm talking to people that are out there? There are some that don't get it. You know why a lot of you or some of you don't get it? Because you don't read God's whole word. Whole word. Not just the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. Not just the New Testament. Although if you read the New Testament in its whole context, you'd get the same message too. But we have to understand, and I don't have time to fully develop, I can't give you all in 5 minutes or 1 hour what you need to know. If you haven't been following the scriptures all along and really listening to what God Almighty's saying, not what Pastor Barley's saying, what God Almighty's saying, you're going to have a problem. You're going to have a problem understanding what's happening to our nation. And I firmly believe that we are the New Jerusalem. Amen. America was founded as a Christian nation by Christian people. Well, why are we not today? Look at us today. Yeah, because we've sinned against God Almighty. We violate His word. And there's much, much more to it. That's just the simple explanation right there. It's either that or He doesn't exist and you can just kiss it all goodbye. Might as well close your Bibles and go to the bar and get drunk. Whatever you're going to do. Doesn't matter anymore because God doesn't exist. You believe in what? Well, the Big Bang Theory is our God, then, in other words. Really? You think you came from a Big Bang Theory? You think you came out of evolution? Oh, I'm evolved. No, you're not evolved. You're devolved, yeah, if you believe that. And it takes commitment. Commitment to what? Commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ and His Word. He says again, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm the Alpha and Omega. And you better put your faith in me or you're going to continue down this same cursed condition that you're going in today. You think Obama's bad? Well, I can put Hillary Clinton in there, he's saying to America, and make it even worse. You think he was bad? You'd probably be wishing for Obama by the time you're through with her. And you know what? I can have her not only in there for 4 years, I can have her in there for 8 years. And I'll raise someone up even worse than her. I got all the time in the world, God Almighty saying to Israel. And He does. Time is of no consequence to Him. Sure is to you. We're all getting older. Not getting any younger. And hopefully, we're gaining wisdom in this. And my commitment is to Him and His Word and His promises. Period. I don't care how long it takes. I don't care what the masses do or don't do. I've told you all before, the majority, even everybody, let's just say, everybody could turn against what I believe and laugh about the Bible, shut their Bibles, and war against Jesus Christ and become worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. I don't care. I have a deep-seated commitment and covenant with God Almighty. And that's where I'm going to stay and remain. I'm certainly not perfect. I don't claim to have all understanding. I may be wrong about a number of things, but I'm not wrong about who Jesus Christ is and His Word. And I'm standing pat. I'm standing upon the promises of God. I have to say this. Multiculturalism exasperates the race problem. Multiculturalism, the mixing of the races, the mixing of all the cultures, the mixing of all the religions, the mixing of whatever out there. And it's an extension of the immigration problem we're facing in our nation today, is it not? Or are you one of those that believes, oh, we're blessed by just opening the border and letting any and everybody come in? You can believe whatever you want to. You can have whatever gods you want to and just bring them into our nation and we'll show our love. And you show us your love by showing us how devoted you are to your paganism and your pagan religion. I'll just ask, is America more Christian today because we let all the Buddhists in? How about all the Hindus and all the Hindu gods and all the Hindu culture? How about the Jews? Are we blessed by letting the Jews into our nation? Are we blessed through the practice of Judaism and Talmudism? If you think that, you don't understand Judaism and Talmudism. And are we blessed by the Muslims and the Islams coming into our country, practicing their religion? You know, when they kill people, like they killed the 14 people here recently and wounded 22 others, they're practicing their religion. Believe it or not, they're practicing their religion. How about the Mexicans? Oh, don't mention the Mexicans. They're our neighbors. Oh, really? They come over here and they're blessing us? They have the same religion that we do? That America was founded upon, I'm talking about? You better rethink that. You better do some more studying and research into that. I brought with me a book that you all need to get. I've read from it before. This is by Ann Coulter. Ann Coulter. Adios, America. And if you don't understand the threat that immigration poses to America, you strongly need to read this book. For instance, I'm going to read to you from page 13 and 14 right now. We'll get to the scriptures. I apologize. I'm just... Page 13 starts off with this paragraph, quote, "How did immigrants become a special interest group more powerful than Americans?" she asks. "I'm not a high-priced political consultant, but shouldn't politicians be more concerned with what citizens think of them than what foreigners do? It's a measure of how out of whack public dialogue is on immigration that it comes as a startling concept to even ask if our laws should help our country rather than help other countries solve their problems. Then on page 14, at what point will Americans remind their government that it has a responsibility to us, not to every sad person in the world? Good statement, good thought. We can't solve everyone's problems, and that's not what we're paying taxes for our government to do. Catholic Charities, she says, Catholic Charities may enjoy taking in immigrant families so that they can feel like the Harriet Tubman of Uganda, but they don't have a right to do it on taxpayers' dime. Now, there's much more. I'll try to read a little bit. I don't think I'll be able to get in back into it, but I'll get into it later. That's just some of the questions she's posing. And she's telling us in very serious terms, we need to wake up. We need to start questioning things. We may not come up with the right answers, but we need to start thinking and we need to start questioning things, especially things we've been taught within the last 30 to 50 years, as though they're truisms. Do these things match up with what the Word of God tells us? That's what we ought to be asking and thinking about. Our enemies, again, our enemies. They actually believe that we are somehow destroyed, that we would be better off, that we would have more prosperity and blessings. Blessings would flow forth from our government, which many of them are in essence worshiping. Don't tell me they don't have a worship system. Don't tell me, even some of you listening, don't have that worship of government system because you're making all kinds of money from it. Now, you may be making all kinds of money from it, but a lot of you certainly understand that we are not to worship the federal government or state government or county government. I'm thinking about this couple who did the killings in San Bernardino, California recently. He worked for the government. He had a huge, fantastic salary. I'm telling you the truth here, folks. He had benefits you'd only dream of. They let him go for an extended period of time over to the Middle East. They let him take time off more than any other employee to go worship at his mosque. He had all kinds of benefits, and then he repays that kindness by going and killing the very people he worked with. Gee, is that an enemy? Is that an enemy ideology and religion that is very foreign from the way we think? Should we not wake up to who the enemy is, therefore? Okay, Lamentations part 1, verse 6. Lamentations chapter 1, verse 6, where we left we're going to continue where we left off last time. And from the daughter of Zion, all her beauty is departed. Her princes are like harts. What's a hart? A stag, a male deer, we could say ram. Many of our leaders do not stand up against our enemies. Instead, they run at the least sign of danger or threat, just like deer do. If you're a hunter, you certainly understand that. Boy, you make a strange noise in the wood and you're out hunting, you're trying to get close to them, boom, they're gone, boy. The smart ones are, that's for sure. But they run at the least sign of a danger or threat. That's what the harts or the deers or the stags do. Going on in verse 6, that find no pleasure, and they are gone without strength before the pursuer. I think that well describes our condition in our nation today, and even the nations of end-time regathered Israel, and the type of leadership that we have today in our nation. But let's not forget that the purpose of divine intervention in this whole thing, Jeremiah and Lamentations, is to lead Israel to repentance, true biblical repentance. And we're not seeing that. As I've told y'all before, we didn't see that at the fall of the Twin Towers. We saw a crying a couple of weeks where we're real sorry we got attacked. They weren't really repenting. Oh, some of them went to church. Is going to church repentance? Give me a break. Getting on your hands and knees before God Almighty and repenting with your whole heart, mind, and soul and meaning it and telling Him, God Almighty, you're going to start obeying Him. You're going to start reading His Word. You're going to start applying His Word. You're going to have a deep-seated commitment and covenant with God Almighty. You're going to seek Him with your whole heart. Now we're getting somewhere when you're going to do that. Verse 7, Jerusalem. Jerusalem remembered in the days of her affliction and of her miseries all her pleasant things that she had in the days of old, when her people fell down into the hand of the enemy, and none did help her. The adversaries saw her and did mock at her Sabbaths. Sabbaths, notice, plural. Land Sabbaths, the holy Sabbaths, the weekly Sabbaths, even the Jubilee, as we talked about last time, mocking what God Almighty has designed for our rest. It has a strong purpose and significance in worship, even for our blessing and restoration. That's why we have these Sabbaths. But we're not obeying them. We're ignoring them. Now remember, Sabbath is a time to rejuvenate, to be uplifted in God's Word. Wow. Now, if we're doing this, we're going to be a lot less susceptible to the deceit and the corruption and the lies of our enemy. We won't be sucked in to the lies of our enemies if we're staying close to Jesus Christ and His Word. How far afield and how far away are we from that? We're way far away, are we not? We've got to return. We've got to turn back to the way, the truth, and the life. Verse 8. Jerusalem hath grievously sinned, therefore she is removed. All that honored her despise her. All that honored her despise her. Think about it. Because they have seen her nakedness. Yea, she sigheth and turneth backwards. Think about it. All that honored her despised her. Is this not happening before our very eyes today? Our enemies do not respect us again. What's it going to take to get through our heads? They do not love us. They do not honor us. They do not respect us because we're not honoring God Almighty and His Word for one thing. Our enemies despise us. They hate us. And they even want to remove us from this planet. That's what killing us is all about. Removing you permanently. Can you imagine a world in which the Muslims were as strong as the United States and had the power of all these nuclear weapons, and they're getting that power. But they had a military, and they had a navy, and they had battleships, and they had these powerful submarines, nuclear submarines. What would the Muslims be doing with all that power? I doubt very seriously if you and I would be here to talk about it. You talk about a guillotine, there would be beheadings right and left. And quite frankly, I'd rather be beheaded than live under them. Wouldn't you? I don't want to live under their depravity. I don't want to live in their paganism. Pastor, they have some similar ways that we do. I don't care. They have a different God. Oh, it's Allah's the same as Yahweh. No, He isn't. I don't care how much and whatever way you want to justify it. They are not Bible-believing people. They do not have Bible-believing ways. They do not want to peacefully coexist with us. They are not comfortable with the Christian faith in any way, shape, or form. They do not respect our nation or honor its history or its achievements or its, dare I say, white culture. Because it is a white culture which gave us these things. The Chinese didn't do it. The Hindus didn't do it. The Eskimos didn't do it. The Pygmies in Africa didn't do it. Oh, how dare you bring it up? It's just so insane. It's a truth. You know what? God Almighty is telling us the truth. Government is lying to you. The universities are lying to you. The school system is lying to you. My wife was telling me just the other day about a mother with a child in kindergarten. And they've been teaching the child, don't listen to your mother or your parents on school items. Only listen to your teacher and obey what the teacher in this kindergarten system is teaching you. Your mother and your father are only your parents. We're your real teachers. I'm not kidding you. And the mother went down and verified this for herself and found out the hard way. And she's awake. Believe me, she's awake right now. She's got her eyes up. Nothing like the truth waking you up. But God's telling us the truth. He doesn't lie to us. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus Christ is our life. Verse 9. Her filthiness, Israel's filthiness, is in her skirts. She remembereth not her last end. She don't even remember the Vietnam War. We don't remember what our past, our recent past. We don't remember what we've gone through or come through. We don't remember the Lyndon Baines Johnson days. We don't remember what happened to us in the 60s or 70s. Therefore, she came down wonderfully. She had no comforter. O Lord, behold my affliction, for the enemy hath magnified himself. What's the enemy done? The enemy hath magnified himself. The adversary has spread out his hand upon all her unpleasant things. For she has seen that the heathen enter into her sanctuary. Pay attention here, everybody. For she has seen that the heathen entered into her sanctuary. I wonder if this means just for a period of time. You better think about what I'm saying. Listen up closely. Is this just for a period of time, then go back to normal? Go back to sin. Going on this verse, it says, whom thou didst command that they should not, God Almighty commanded that they should not enter into thy congregation. Israel, you're not to be unequally yoked together. Israel, you're to separate from these heathen pagan people. I wonder if it really means that. Maybe there's another interpretation here. Maybe I'm just getting it all wrong. We have to stop here and examine what we just read, ladies and gentlemen. We have to stop and examine what we just got through reading before we go on and determine whether this is really real or not, and maybe we better be practicing it, applying it if it's true. And if it's not true, well, then let's have multiculturalism, whatever. Just bring any and everybody together. Just bring all the black people together, all the Chinese people, all the Indians, everybody together into our congregation. Let them play with our kids. Have one big multicultural family. Let them intermarry. Let them play with one another. Let them intermingle with them. Let them invite them over our house. Let us have Bible studies. Let us just sleep over the house. Just have no end to it. If what I'm reading here is wrong. Oh, I know that's a hard, tough message. Well, let's go to the book of Deuteronomy. Before we do this, and read what we're going to read in Deuteronomy 23. Let me tell you this. Separation is not our enemy. It's our friend. Separation, biblical separation, is not evil. It's biblical. All right. Deuteronomy 23, verse 1. Whoops, I went one chapter over here. Let me get back. Bear with me here. Let's just start in verse 7. He that is wounded in his stones, or hath his privy members cut off, shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. Now that's just for starters. You may not like or agree with what you just read, but that's what it says. Here we go. A bastard or a mamzer. And I know lots of you out there are already jumping ahead of me. Yeah, but this doesn't mean this. It means that. We haven't gotten into what it means yet. A bastard shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord, even to his 10th generation. Oh, see, Pastor? 10th generation. That means that a black can marry a white and they can have a child. Now, if a mamzer and a bastard, they're not of your kindred, and you allow that child into your congregation, oh, I know how hard that sounds. I didn't say it can't be in their church, a black church. Well, we're not to allow this race mixing like we've got today. There's something definitely wrong. Or I'm misreading the scriptures totally, and I got lots of verses on it, lots of them. But we're just covering these verses right now. And so that means that this bastard child, or man's or child, if you don't like the word bastard, it's a biblical term, can go off and marry another white person, let's say, later when they get older. It's a mamzer child from a black and a white marriage, and they'll go out and marry a white person to have a child. And this continues on and on and on for 10 generations. And then, oh, it's okay now. We can come in church. It means if it was wrong on day one, it's still wrong later. But, Pastor, you're not reading the scriptures correctly. It says to the 10th generation. Well, I know what you're thinking. You're just thinking what I told you. And you think about it. Is that right? We can just keep violating and violating what the scriptures told us, that it's wrong to do that, and then in somehow in the 10th generation, we're all pure. No, it means, as we read earlier, it's wrong to do it forever. In other words, what I'm telling you here is that this verse means forever. You're going to have a hard time proving that to me, Pastor. Well, I know what you're thinking. And I'm trying to be kind about this, but maybe your thinking's wrong. Let's put it that way. Because let's go to Nehemiah chapter 13, verse 1. Nehemiah 13, verse 1. On that day, and this after repentance, on that day they read in the book of Moses the laws of God. In other words, in the audience of the people, meaning the people of Israel, and therein was found written that the Ammonite, think about it, and the Moabite should not come into the congregation of the Lord forever. Note the words forever, just like we read earlier in Lamentations. What's the truth? What's the truth here? Were these people removed from Israelite worship? Well, what do you mean by that, Pastor? I mean, these other races, are they removed? Is God Almighty, His law, telling them, remove them, have a separation? You black people go worship in your black church with a black minister. What's wrong with that? Sorry if you have a problem with that. Or the Indians, you go worship with the Indians. I'm not saying there cannot be help given. I'm not saying that it's wrong to reach out and be kind to the other races. They're kind to us. If you've lived any length of time, you know, we were in San Antonio recently. My mother passed away. And we were at the Alamo, a number of our family members, and I wanted to get a picture of our family there at the Alamo. I thought that would be cool to have. And there was this Mexican family down there right next to us. And we asked this Mexican lady, would you mind taking a picture? She put a big smile on her face and said, yes, I'd love to. And she came over there and took a couple of pictures and was very kind to us. That's because many of them are friends of Israel. We're not to treat them mean just because they're of another race. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying it's mean to them. It's mean to the offspring. It's mean to the purposes of God when we multiculturalize ourselves. They're much more comfortable with their own kind and their own culture and their own ways. We, believe it or not, white people, are meant to be with our own kind. Does that mean we're going to be free of problems and we're not going to have separation and disagreement? Well, of course not. But we are much more comfortable among our own kind. And we are to be with our own kind. It's the mystery Babylon way to do this multicultural thing. You'll see it more and more in the commercials, see it more and more in the movies, the multiculturalism way. What does that do? That destroys us. Like I've said, you take, whether you like this example or not, you take a glass of milk and you pour chocolate into it, it's no longer milk. It's something else. And if we kept that up and kept that up, just take it to its conclusion, isn't that destroying our race? Yes, it is. And it's destroying their race too. It's Babylon that wants to multiculturalize. It's Babylon that wants to bring this immigration policy in and to drown us and flood us. And when the Bible talks about a flood, oftentimes it's talking about that, a flood of immigration. Now, I know we haven't gotten very far into this, but I think we've covered some serious things. And you're free to question, free to think about, free to look this up and examine what I've told you and find out what God's Word really says. And I don't care what direction you go on this, you're not going to escape the fact that many of the things that we're reading about in Lamentations as an example, are happening because God Almighty is bringing these things upon us as a form of punishment. We are being punished to the point where we will cry out, "Oh, Pastor, it's so bad today." Really? You got food in your stomach. You have still a lot of blessings, even though we have a lot of problems. You have a lot of blessings today to be thankful for. But I'm afraid that we're in for a rough time. If you're riding the wrong horse for you, your butt's going to be sore. And God Almighty has got us on this Bronco that's throwing us, and it's kicking us every little which way you can think of. And right now, we're getting ready to get thrown off. And we're going to find out real quick. This rodeo that we're in is not a very pleasant rodeo to be in. We'll close at this juncture for now. Pray for these messages. Pray, as many others are learning out there and appreciating, thank God for these messages. We're one of the few churches, there's others, that are telling the truth and willing to tell the whole truth of God's Word. We need the whole truth of God's Word today. Lord Jesus, we love you. We love your Word, the whole Word of God, because you're not just the God of the New Testament. You're the God of the same covenants and promises of the Old Testament unto Israel that are in the New Testament. That only Israel is mentioned in the New Covenant, and that it is Israel who mainly needs to wake up to their true biblical identity, to the true calling and purposes of your Word. We're not waiting for the other people to wake up. We're waiting for Israel to wake up. And we know that the things you're bringing upon us as a people and nation and nations of end time regathered Israel are for that very purpose, to wake us up. Hallelujah for that. We thank you for your work, even though it's unpleasant for us to go through. But in the end, we'll be so blessed because the brightness of your kingdom will come and become much more clear in the days ahead. And we thank you for it, love you for it, Jesus. Amen.